Hey, hello everyone. In this video lecture, we will study the Payment of Wages Act, and in this we will also discuss the various important provisions of the Payment of Wages Act 1936. So let's start with the video lecture. Payment of Wages Act. So the Payment of Wages Act regulates the payment of wages to the certain classes of person employed in an industry. The Act guarantees payment of wages on time and without any deductions except those that are authorized under this Act. This Act does not apply to the person whose wages is 10,000 or more per month. Extent of the Act. This Act extends to the whole of India. It was extended to the Jammu and Kashmir by the Central Labour Law Extension to the Jammu and Kashmir Act of 1970. Now, application of the Act. The Act applies to the payment of wages to the person employed in any factory, to a person employed or otherwise in a factory upon the railway or railway administration, or a person employed in an industrial or other establishment specified under the Section 2 of this Act. The state government may, after giving the three month notice for the extension of this Act, the extension of the provision of this Act by the official notification in the official gazette. Now, the definitions. So the Section 2 has defined the various definitions. So under this, the first definition is employed person. So employed person includes the person who is employed in an industry as well as its legal representative of a deceased employed person. Next definition is employer. Employer means the person who generally employs a lot of employees in his industry. It also includes the legal representative of deceased person. Next definition is factory. Factory means the factory which is defined under the Section 2M of the Factories Act 1948 and includes any place to which the provision of this Act has been applied. Next definition is industrial or other establishment means any tramway services, motor transport services, air transport services, dock, inland vessel, mechanically propelled machineries, mines, quarry, oil field, plantation and workshops, etc. Now, the next definition is wages. Wages means all the remuneration, whether by the way of a salary, allowances or otherwise expressed in the terms of money, are known as wages. Now, the various provisions of Payment of Wages Act 1936. Under this, the first provision is the rules for the payment of wages. Under this, responsibility for the payment of wages. So every employer shall be responsible for the payment of wages to the person employed by him of all wages required to be paid under this Act. The following persons shall be responsible for the payment of wages. In factories, if a person has been named as a manager, is responsible for the payment of wages. And in industry or other establishment, if there is a person responsible for the employer for the supervision and control of industry, is responsible for the payment of wages. And upon the railway, if employer is the railway administration and the railway administration has nominated a person in this behalf for a local area concerned, is responsible for the payment of wages. Now, the Section 4 has the provision, that is fixation of wage period. So it shall fix the wage period in respect of the wages shall be payable. No wage period shall exceed to the 1 month, and means the payment of wages wage period can't be more than the 1 month, and the payment of wages can be made also by a daily, weekly, fortnightly or on the monthly basis. Now, the Section 5 has a provision, that is time for the payment of wages. So any railway factory or industries or other establishment where less than 1,000 persons are employed then the payment of wages shall be paid before the expiry of 7th day of the next month, and in case of more than 1,000 persons are employed, then the wages shall be paid before the expiry of 10th day from the next month. So these are the rules for the payment of wages. Now, the next provision is for the reduction from the wages defined under the section 7 to 13. Now, first one is the reduction which may be made from the wages under the section 7. So, section 7 provide that the wages of an employed person shall be paid to him without deductions of any kind except those authorized by or under the Payment of Wages Act 1936. So there are the various kinds of deductions, that is for the deductions for the fine, deductions for the absence from the duty, deduction from the damages or the loss, and deductions for the services, and also the reduction for the recovery of advances, and deductions for the recovery of loans, and also the reduction for the payment of cooperative societies and insurance schemes. So there is also a limit on the deductions which is done by the employer from the wages. The limit shall be that is the total amount of deduction which may be made under the above head shall not exceed to 75% of the above wages. In case where the such deductions are wholly or partly made for the payment of cooperative societies, and in other cases it shall not exceed to the 50% of such wages. Now, the next provision is for the maintenance of registered and records defined under the section 13A. So every employer shall maintain register and records and giving them following particulars of a person employed by him, that is the work performed by the employees and the wages paid to the employees and the reduction made from their wages and also the receipt given to them, that is we can say pay slip. So they shall be preserved for a period of 3 years from the date of the last entry has been made, and the register and record shall be in such a form as may be prescribed under this act. Now the next provision is the enforcement of this act. Under the enforcement of this act, the inspectors are appointed under the section 14. So an inspector of a factory appointed under the Factories Act 1948 shall be the inspector for the purpose of the Payment of Wages Act in respect of all the factories. So the appropriate government may also, by the notification in official gazette, appoint such person as he thinks fit to be the inspector for the purpose of this act. Now the next provision under this is inspector deemed to be a public servant. So every inspector shall deem to be a public servant within the meaning of an Indian Penal Code 1816. Now next is facilities to be afforded to inspector. So every employer shall afford an inspector all reasonable facilities for making an entry, inspection, supervision, examination and inquiry under this act. Next is the power and functions of inspector. So an inspector may make such examination or inquiry as he thinks fit in order to ascertain if the provision of this act or a rule made there under are being observed. Now with such assistance, if any, he thinks fit, enter and inspect and search any premises of any railway factory or industries or any other establishment at the reasonable time for the purpose of carrying out the object of this act. Next power is supervise the payment of wages to the person employed upon any railway or in any factory or industrial or other establishment. Next is it requires by a written order for the production at such places as may prescribe of any registered or record maintained under this act. Now next power is seize or take the copies of register or a document or a portion thereof as he may consider relevant in the respect of offences under this act, and he can also exercise such other power as may be prescribed under this act. Now next is that who may file the application. So an application for the claim arising under this act shall be filed by a person who is employed himself or any legal practitioner, means an advocate, any official of registered trade union authorized in a writing to act in his behalf, means behalf of an employee, and any inspector under this act, and any person acting with the permission of an authority appointed. Now, application is to be filed within the 12 months. So, every application for a claim under this Act shall be presented within 12 months from the date on which the deduction from the wages was made or from the date on which the payment of wages was due to be made. Now, the next provision is of appeal. So an appeal may be preferred in a presidency town before the district court against an order diminishing either wholly or a part or in a part an application made under this Act, and also for a direction made under this Act by the authority for a payment of penalty to the employed person the amount deducted from the wages under this Act. And the appeal may be preferred within the 30 days of the date on which the order of a direction was made. So the next provision is that penalty for the offences under this Act. Now, penalty for delaying in the payment of wages within the prescribed period or making an unauthorized deduction, whoever being responsible, or the payment of wages to an employed person, delay in payment of wages within the period laid down under this Act shall be punishable with a fine which shall not be less than 1500 but which may extend to 1500. Now, next penalty is that is penalty for not paying the wages on a working day or in a current coin or a not recording fines or not displaying any abstract of this Act shall be then for these offences he shall be punishable with a fine which may extend to 3715 for such offences. Now the next offence is that penalty for failure to maintain or furnish the record or return. So he shall be punishable with a fine which shall not be less than 200 rupees but which may extend to rupees 1000. Now the next penalty is for the penalty for obstructing the inspector. If any person willfully obstruct an inspector in the discharge of his duties under this Act and willfully refuse to produce on the demand of an inspector any register or other documents kept under this Act, and shall be punishable with a fine which may not be less than 1500 but which may extend to 7500. So these are all penalties under this Act. Now, thank you very much for listening it very patiently.